So good afternoon. We're going to get started with our TexWorks conference call with Clay Shirky. I hope all of you can hear me as we're beginning this process, and as people keep joining, we'll be welcoming them as well. A few different pieces of information to share with all of you as we get started in this conversation. First, we wanted to explain a few technical items just as we get started. One, for those of you joining us by telephone, you do not need to be on telephone. If it's more convenient for you to be simply on your computer, you can watch the webinar and listen from your computer's speakers. Second, if you don't have speakers on your computer, alternatively, you are able to join on the telephone and call into that number. So, second, wanted to share with you who is on this call. This is, as many of you know, there are participants from our recent Schusterman Networks gathering in Boulder. There are friends and family and extended members of the Charles Lynn Schusterman Family Foundation Network of community members, Schusterman Foundation Israel community members, and members of the ROI community. Also, wanted to remind you, one of the reasons why we're doing this was to bring knowledge and thinking around networks into our community through some of the leading experts that are thinking, writing, and speaking about this, not just in the Jewish world, but in the world broadly. So, the three things that I want to also make sure I thank, the three groups I want to thank is, one, the colleagues and staff here at the foundation who have helped pull this together. Two, the several members of this community that have participated within this particular program to help facilitate a series of book talks that led up to this conversation. Sarah Eisenman, Sarah Benor, Jen Rosen, Ari Weiss, and Will Berkowitz. All played a role in helping plan and facilitate some of the conversations that we have had leading up until this point. And of course, I want to thank Lynn Schusterman, who, as often she says, she makes it possible, but you all make it happen. And in this call, she certainly made this opportunity possible, but your participation and involvement is making it happen. So I want to quickly walk through the format of the call and then turn it over to Clay. Clay is going to speak and share a presentation for about 30 to 40 minutes, giving some insights from the books he's written and some ideas he's had subsequently. There are going to be questions that you can write and share and stream into this webinar that we're going to be taking careful notes on and sharing with Clay. And then we're going to try and answer and ask as many questions as we can during this process. The other thing that we want to share with you is this conversation is going not just on this webinar, but out in cyberspace, and you can use our JNet hashtag, as well as reference Clay's Twitter handle on CS Shirky, it's C-S-H-I-R-K-Y, as well as on our Facebook pages. So I know many of you have read about Clay on our invitations and on our Facebook page. We want to share with you just a few introductory comments about Clay. He teaches theory and practice of social media at NYU, where he's an associate arts professor in the Interactive Telecommunications Program and a distinguished writer in residence at the Arthur L. Carter Journalism Institute. He's the author of three books on social media, Cognitive Surplus, recently written in 2010, Here Comes Everybody, which I know many of you are familiar with from reading as part of the TexWorks project, and Voices from the Net, which really was a pioneering text in 1994. His writings on the internet and media can be found at shirky.com. And as many of you know from checking out our recent Facebook updates, he's been speaking frequently on many of the current issues that we have been experiencing over the past several months as social media becomes more and more of a dominant way of building and bridging networks. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Clay to let him begin his presentation. Thank you again, Clay, for participating and joining us today, and take it away.
Not at all. Thank you so much for having me. Thank you for that introduction. Yeah, I'm obviously here to talk about the ways in which new media tools are changing how groups of people find each other, come together, agree on things, decide to get things done. And rather than talk about that in the abstract, I'll just start with a story that happened a couple years ago. It started here with this image. This is from January 2009. a group of women in a bar in Mangalore, India, were set upon by a group of men who went into the bar, dragged women out of the bar bodily, were slapping them and kicking at them. When men stepped in to intervene, the attackers also attacked the men. And it was, as is by now usual, the whole thing was documented on camera phones, photos and videos uploaded to Flickr and YouTube and so forth. And this quickly made its way to Indian media. These images of this attack were then shown on Indian media. And shortly after the images appeared in public, this guy showed up, Pramod Mutalik, who was the head of a Hindu fundamentalist group called Sri Ram Sena, which means Lord Ram's army or God's army. And what Mutalik said when these images went up was, "We attacked those women. And we attacked them because they were not living up to our idea of Hindu womanhood. They were not being sufficiently chaste. They were not being sufficiently private. And we're going to attack them again on Valentine's Day." So Sri Ram Sena said, "If you are a woman in the Mangalore province, we cast you out of doors on Valentine's Day with a man who's not your blood relative, we will attack you again." So this leaves the women of Mangalore province with a classic collective action dilemma. Each woman has to decide for herself, if I want to defy this order to stay home, if I don't like being told I have to stay indoors, I can turn out in the streets. But in doing so, I also risk getting attacked. So I could also decide, maybe I'll let the other people turn out in the streets and they can take the political heat and I'll stay home and be safe. But of course, if everybody makes that second decision, Then Sri Ram Sena has won. Then they have said to women, "You must stay indoors." But there was, by 2009, another way to solve collective action dilemmas. And it was set on by this woman, Nisha Susan, who was a journalist who worked in Mangalore. And what Nisha Susan realized was that you could solve collective action dilemmas collectively. So what she did is she went out and founded a Facebook group called the Consortium of Loose, Forward, and Pub-Going Women. And the Consortium of Loose, Forward, and Pub-Going Women really had only one role, which is to provide a public platform for disagreeing with Sri Ram Sena and for defying his order to Mangalore women to stay indoors. So their first and, as it turned out, only action was to propose an underwear upgrade for Sri Ram Sena on Valentine's Day. Sena tended to favor a style of khaki shorts that looked a little bit like diapers, so they were sometimes called chadiwalas, diaper wearers. So the women of the Consortium of Loose, Forward, and Pub-Going Women decided they were going to mail a bunch of pink underpants to Sri Ram Sena's members. So they went out, they bought pink underwear, they wrote little messages on the back, they folded them up, they put them in envelopes, put them in the mail, and sent it off to Sena headquarters. And of course, this enraged Mutalik, and this enraged Sri Ram Sena. But it also had another effect, which is that the government took notice. It recognized that there were a group of citizens willing to undergo, not just a kind of cyber protest, not just clicktivism as it's sometimes called, but to spend real money and to put their real names on these packages to send a political message. And so the government acted by arresting Mutalik and several of the lieutenants of Sri Ram Sena for the pub attacks. And they just happened to arrest them on January 13th, so that everybody was in custody on Valentine's Day. And there were no attacks on Valentine's Day of that year, and there have been no attacks since. And this is, of course, a story of someone figuring out how to use social media to coordinate a group that share an interest but don't have anything else in common. They're not all members of the same organization. They're not all reachable by the same formal tools, and yet, in a moment of need, they could be assembled. And as I read many of the questions and comments, such fascinating questions and comments that came from out of the textbook book group, many of the questions were, what has changed since you wrote Here Comes Everybody? This story, I think, illustrates one of the changes, which is that when I was writing Here Comes Everybody in 2006, 2007, I was mostly looking for examples that I thought foreshadowed what was coming. Now I'm mostly just trying to keep up with what's already happening. It is breaking out in so many different places. It's gone from being a largely American-centric set of episodes, use of social media, to being absolutely positively global. And where the leaders of many of these movements, as with Nisha Susan, are not techies. They're not people who understand the tools. They're people who have a good social sense of what will motivate people to take action. And the other change underlying all of this, of course, is that it, as was impossible to imagine even in 2007, Facebook has become such a global platform, such a global resource for undertaking this kind of social coordination, this kind of media use, that it provides those tools to more people in a more global setting at lower cost and with greater ease of use than even was the case when I was writing that book. So the Nisha Souza story is an example, I think, of what happens when social media gets deeper into society, cheaper to use, and easier to understand. Right. And of course, that effect has become more general still. Another thing that's changed since I wrote the book is the change in politics, the real alteration of political outcomes, as of course with the Arab Spring, right, where you see people not just using these tools to help oppose the state, as in Tunisia and Egypt, and more recently Bahrain, Yemen, Syria, and so on. But you also see them referencing these tools in the protest signs, that they're specifically saying, we have something you don't have, we have access to something you don't have, and we're going to highlight that difference, which is cultural as much as it is technological, in opposing the Mubarak regime, in opposing the Ben Ali regime. And then, of course, there's the Occupy movement. The famous pepper spraying incident at UC Davis was interesting, not just because the Occupy movement had used these tools to spread the word to help organize, as is by now becoming normal, but because it turns out that the documentation, the ability of people to tell the truth about their own lives, is an enormously political, powerful gesture, one that I had underestimated when I wrote Here Comes Everybody, and I think even to some degree underestimated when I wrote the second book, when I wrote Cognitive Surplus, because we're seeing over and over again that the ability of people to tell the truth about their own lives means that the idea of a single master narrative that is broadcast in the media is simply disrupted all the time. Right. And in the case of the UC Davis pepper spraying incident, UC Davis's story that these kids were somehow rowdy and had to be displaced because they constituted some kind of threat. When you hold that up against the image of Lieutenant Pike casually pepper spraying completely inert students, the UC Davis's narrative collapsed. Most recently, perhaps as recently as last week, with the Pipa Sopa protest, the protest against the bills, the copyright bills in the House and the Senate, the principal mechanism of enforcement was censorship. Censorship in some cases of foreign infringing sites, but much more dramatically, censorship of local social networks if the users were discussing or pointing to those sites. And that deal was presumed to be a lock in Congress. I knew activists in the fall who said, well, the MPAA really seems to have their ducks in a row. This thing has been, you know, it was unanimously sent out of committee. It's headed towards a vote. I don't see any way we can stop it. And it got stopped, again, by the ability of people not just to coordinate using these tools, but to document the results, to say to Senator Schumer and Gillibrand in New York, among other places, not only are we turning out, but we're making images of us turning out to protest so widely available that you can't claim that this is a minority concern any longer. And the speed with which SOPA and TIPA collapsed were pretty remarkable. Now, this brings up an interesting question of leadership and of organizational leadership especially, because the commonality across many of these events, not just in Tunis and Cairo, but also in Athens and Jerusalem and Santiago and Oakland and New York, is that we're seeing a bifurcation of the old role of political organizing. It used to be that when some goal was achieved by a political group, that political group took control, right? To the question, for example, who will be in charge of Tunisia, the answer would ordinarily be, well, whatever group was organized enough to take down the Ben Ali regime. or who should we negotiate with around copyright with PIPA and SOPA now that the old bills have collapsed? The answer would be whatever organization organized the protest well enough to be a new force in the field. What we're seeing now with this bifurcation is that it is easy to assemble coalitions that cause things to collapse, but those coalitions are not also set up to take charge afterwards. The people who caused Ben Ali to flee the country were not set up to run Tunisia. The people who caused Mubarak to flee the country were not set up to run Egypt. And so we start to see this tension between organizations or groups essentially that self-assemble around a problem. It is easier to get a larger coalition together around stopping something happening than it is to get a coalition to start something happening. And this, I think, is an important lesson for the role of organizations, which is the kind of structure needed to actually manage things in an ongoing way is still at a premium, even in a world where relatively easy group assembly is now part of the media environment. So let me tell another story that I think illustrates some of what organizations are now starting to be able to take advantage of in terms of problem solving, in terms of taking this media and saying not, oh, this is going to replace the organizational model, but rather saying our organization can now use this ability of citizens to coordinate themselves as a new tool, as a new resource. So this is a map from December 2010. DARPA, the Defense Advanced Research Projects Administration, started what they called the Red Balloon Challenge, and they just wanted to see how people would cooperate to solve a problem. So what they said was, we put up 10 weather balloons around the United States, and anybody who can tell us within a mile the location of all 10 balloons will win a $40,000 prize. So there was a group at MIT that looked at this problem and said, oh, we know how to solve that. We'll just ask people, and we'll tell them if they tell us where a balloon is, we'll give them part of the prize money. So right away, you've got an incentive to disclose the information if you know where one of the balloons are. But that way they had an incentive to get someone to identify where the balloons were, but they did not yet have an incentive to get that message to spread. So the next move MIT made was to say, we're going to also give prize money to anybody who introduces us to someone who knows where a balloon is, and we will give a slice of the prize money to someone who introduces us to someone who introduces us to someone who knows where the balloon is. And suddenly they've solved the motivation problem. They've provided a way to get the message not just back to them, but also to spread outwards across all of these social networks so that everybody has an incentive to ask their friends, hey, do you know where any of these red balloons are? And if you don't, would you please spread this message to ask your friends if they know? And the messages indeed ripple through the social networks. So a couple of interesting things about this strategy. The first one is MIT One. Right, the team that came up with this idea of harnessing group intelligence through the correct design of motivations actually won the prize. The second interesting thing, and you can see in this column of who the winners are, the MIT team was the only team to get the location of all 10 balloons correctly. But the third interesting thing, and perhaps the most interesting thing, DARPA had allotted 30 days. The challenge was going to last 30 days, and whoever got closest within 30 days was going to be the one to win the prize money. The MIT team solved it in 9 hours. So DARPA overestimated the amount of time this challenge might need by a factor of 80. And that, I think, is indicative of the continually deepening power of these networks. It's not just that they make low-cost group assembly possible, which they have done for some time now, but the fact that these tools are so ubiquitous and so deeply wired into, especially the American situation, that if you get the message right, if you get the motivations right, a message can spread dramatically much faster and dramatically much further than it would have previously, and you can uncover what you might call hidden experts. You can uncover the people who, even though you wouldn't think, oh, that person, they are an expert balloon finder, might have a key piece of information that you needed. And this is, I think, one of the big changes to the role of expertise in general. One of the advantages that experts have always had isn't just that they know a lot of things, but that they're easily findable. And now as we start to be able to find people who have distributed information, suddenly there is an alternate way to aggregate the things we want to know other than going to the experts and asking. So if we take seriously this idea that this is a new resource, that this is a new thing we can take advantage of, we need a name for it. The name I've started to use is cognitive surplus. Cognitive surplus is made of two things. It's made of the free time and talents of the world's connected population, coupled with the connection of that population itself, coupled with that population's ability to talk to one another over a network at global scale. So I wanted some way to talk about cognitive surplus. I wanted some way to measure this. So I took the largest example we have of cognitive surplus, which is Wikipedia. And in 2008, at the time that I was first working on these ideas, I did a back-of-the-envelope calculation with a friend of mine, Martin Wattenberg, about Wikipedia. And we came to the conclusion that Wikipedia had taken at that point something like 100 million hours of human thought to create. Right. There's obviously a huge number. Anything that takes 100 million hours is obviously an enormous effort. So Wikipedia is, as I said, the largest example we have of this surplus being aggregated. But how big is it compared to the amount of free time the world has overall? So we needed something else to compare it to. I took television because it is the number one use of free time worldwide. But if you imagine a graphic representation of television watching in the United States, how big is that? Right. It is 200 billion hours in the U.S. alone every year. Right. So it is orders of magnitude larger than Wikipedia. Rendered graphically, Wikipedia is here. The entire project, the entire 10-year project, is a rounding error on the amount of television we watch in the United States in a single year. To put that another way, we spend a Wikipedia's worth of time in this country alone every weekend just watching ads. And when you see how large that number is, you realize that the ability to carve out even small bits of this cognitive surplus can have enormous effects if you get the messages right. The key, of course, again, the message is right, is to figure out what kinds of things motivate people in order to get them to participate. And so harnessing this cognitive surplus can lead to incredible expansions of scientific, literary, artistic, and political creativity. And it can also lead to lots and lots of lolcats, as you see on the screen. Lolcats are pictures of cute cats made even cuter with the addition of cute captions. And this, of course, too, is another use of the cognitive surplus, right? The I'm just going to crack my friends up on their coffee break use of cognitive surplus, where people are forwarding around videos, oh my goodness, this guy fell off the skateboard, you have to see this. And whenever you put forward the idea that the network population might be able to achieve important new advances in science and literature and the arts and the humanities, This is the response you get, which is, what, the thing with the cats? Like, you can't be serious that a medium that is very good at circulating pictures of cute cats is also somehow going to be socially or politically important. But here's the thing. That always happens. And I don't just mean it always happens with the internet. I mean it always happens with media, full stop. It did not take long after the printing press was invented for the first erotic novels to appear. It didn't take long before someone who was in the business of selling books said, hey, you know what I bet people would pay for? But it took another 150 years for anybody to even think of the scientific journal. Right? We got erotic novels because we're the kind of people we are and the printing press is the kind of thing it is. The scientific journal took a group of people committing to using those tools in a way that actually improved their area of inquiry, the things they were interested in. We get lolcats because we're the kind of people we are, and the web is the kind of medium it is. But the stuff that's going to matter with the use of these tools is when a group of people says, we can harness that power, but we can apply it to things that are that are important to us, that are not just about cracking people up on their lunch breaks, but are actually about disseminating the world's knowledge or improving negotiations between people or taking on large-scale collective action problems. And that really becomes, I think, the organizational challenge here, which is how do you take the kinds of things these tools offer in terms of coordinating people and synchronizing their opinions and actually apply it to problems that matter. So let me make two points, I think, that are critical for organizations to take on board in thinking through the use of this medium. The first is that you have to get rid of the audience illusion. And the audience illusion is that an organization serves a group of people who are largely the same and whose behavior and commitment to one another and to the organization is largely the same. This is, for a membership organization, this is the model that says essentially we have an annual conference and we produce a newsletter, you give us some money and we agree to call that membership. Right. What actually happens whenever users are given a real voice and the opportunity to participate, not just to fund and then receive, is that the idea of a relatively uniform behavior of an audience of people completely blows up. So this picture is what's sometimes called the Horowitz Triangle, named after Bradley Horowitz, then of Yahoo, now of Google, who observed across several different projects at Yahoo. Every time, Horowitz said, every time we launch something that opens the door to user involvement, we see the idea of the audience blow up, and instead what we see is this. For any given thing, about 9 people out of 10 will just come in and say, you know what, I like to watch this stuff. This is funny with the cat videos or whatever it is, but I'm not here to do anything. I'm just here on the sidelines. About 10% of the audience will be participants. They will be remixing. They will be forwarding things. They will be recommending. They will be curating. And then about 1%, the core of the participants, will be the most active makers and the most committed members. And the trick for an organization is not how do we get everyone to be a creator. The trick for an organization is to drop the idea that everybody has to be the same or that everybody has to be highly committed. And to understand instead that in an ecosystem like this, people will find their way to their own level of comfort. And in many ways, the large audience that forms is part of the motivation for the creators and synthesizers. The other thing to understand is that when you offer several different kinds of opportunities to participate, different people come forward as creators or synthesizers, and different people lean back as consumers. So that it becomes not a question of how can we get everybody equally and highly excited, because you can't. The question instead becomes, how can we create an ecosystem where people can come forward in some cases, lean back in other cases, and can find their way to whatever equilibrium state matters to them. The other thing that's key for an organization to understand is how much value has shifted from we decide or create some material relevant to you and we give it to you versus the new value that's easier to get, which is we are actually performing a convening function in which you are creating value for each other. So here's an example of a value-creating site convenes people. It's called Stack Overflow. It's for Windows programmers. But it was very popular even among Microsoft employees because it was populated by hardcore Windows programmers answering questions in the real world for one another. Right? And you look at a site like Stack Overflow where Windows programmers are congregating and creating this kind of aggregate value for one another. And you say, what is it that these people out in the field have that Microsoft engineers don't have? Microsoft invented Windows. If anybody should understand what's going on with Windows, it should be inside Microsoft. And yet here the Microsoft employees are on Stack Overflow. And the answer to the question, what do the people on Stack Overflow, what do they have access to that Microsoft doesn't have, is they have access to reality. Right. Within Microsoft, they can only model a tiny percentage of the complexity of the real world. I want this program on that machine to do this function in that environment. The users, in aggregate, actually had much greater real-world experience than Microsoft can ever model on the inside. And once you see an organization's value in terms of its potential convening function, you start to ask the question, what do our users or members or consumers know because they are using our product or service or they are members of our organization in a way that puts them out on the front lines, that puts them out in the real world? You can start to say, how can I harness that power? Not, how can I somehow continue to deliver to them things that put me in the role of publisher and them in the role of consumer, but rather, how can I create a platform where they are creating value for one another? Stack Overflow went down this path several times once they'd seen what they'd done with Windows. They created a related site for PhD level and above mathematics, which is now very popular. They created a site for people talking about startups. They created a site for cooking. Really, anything that's geeky enough that the experts will get something out of talking to one another. And so Stack Overflow is, I think, an example of an organization that said, we're getting past the we produce and you consume model, and we're getting into the we convene model, where the aggregate of the participants and the platform create more value than either group could on their own. And the most remarkable thing about Stack Overflow, and this is, I think, the third lesson for organizations trying to take this on, is that they've set up what's called a karma system. Many sites have this now. And a karma system says, we're not going to treat all users the same. If you just got here and we don't know you, we're not going to give you the keys to the kingdom. We're going to let you answer questions, look at these posts, but really you're just there as a participant. But as we get to know you, and as we see that you're committed to the site and significantly to the other members of the site, as your karma score goes up, as you can see here, we're going to give you more and more influence. Until by the end, at the bottom there, with 10,000 karma points, which is an enormous number, we're actually going to treat you like a co-owner. And what's really remarkable to me about this model is what Stack Overflow has said is, the old organizational barrier, we are the employees and you are the customers, and we're on the inside and you're on the outside, has given way to a membrane in which people who've just showed up are treated as customers, they're treated as users, they're treated at arm's length. But that if you stick around and you are committed enough and we can see that you are doing the work we are doing, that we all share the same goals, what happens is that those users become essentially co-operators of the site. And this path from outside to inside, not as a threshold, you didn't used to be an employee and now you're an employee, but rather as something that you build up through sweat equity, is much more reflective of organizations that operate outside the marketplace, like religious congregations, where in addition to the formal functions of the priest or the imam or the rabbi or what have you, you also have people who are, just by deepening their commitment, becoming increasingly important members of the congregation. It's a model that has not seen a lot of work out in the last couple of hundred years, given the success of the market model, where being an employee or not is the key divider. But now people are discovering, particularly for membership organizations, that having some way of recognizing and handing over power, not just to the user base as a whole, which is the convening function, but to locating those individual users who do a disproportionate amount of the work, and essentially recognizing in them what everybody knows, which is they're the people who keep the lights on around here, they're the people who settle disputes, they're the people who understand what makes this place worthwhile. And I think we're seeing an increasing number of organizations moving in this direction, going away from the pure service model, you give me money, I give you a service, whether it's a for-profit or non-profit company. And more people saying, I can create, more and more organizations rather saying, I can create value for my users, members, customers, if I convene them as a whole and if I recognize that subset of them that's most committed. So let me end here with a list of questions, which I will not read to you, but which are, I think, the kinds of questions that organizations are starting to ask themselves in an age where cognitive surplus is a resource you can imagine taking advantage of. Because all of a sudden, works for me, doesn't work for me, is an employee, is an outsider, stops being the only way that you can think about value. And we are moving into a world where all kinds of co-creation of value can be created, provided an organization can come forward as a platform that enables users to create value for each other. So I'll end there and assume we'll have some questions.
Great. Clay, thank you for the excellent presentation.
Thanks so much.
Based on some of the chat we've seen and questions we've seen, you've struck a bunch of nerves. So I want to ask you a few questions that I'm going to frame.
Yep.
First, I want to let you know, after your presentation, people have been chiming in from across the United States, from Israel, from Europe, and really, it's resonating with a lot of folks. So the first question I want to share with you is actually from one of our colleagues at the Jim Joseph Foundation, Aideen Sachs, who asks, what is the role of the organization in the transition points of kind of aggregated action? So in other words, what should organizations do when the action is stopped and what it wanted it to stop?
I would love to say I know what the answer is. That is probably the most important open question right now. We have at least one working example in the Tea Party, and I have to say I'm not much in agreement with their politics, but that was an example of a group that started with one of these, it was an emergent phenomenon, right? There were hundreds of Tea Parties all of a sudden within weeks, literally, of the thing being kicked off. There were hundreds of groups just meeting spontaneously under that banner and starting the conference calls. And what they recognized was that the ongoing leverage point was electoral politics. And they, more successfully, I think, than any other political group, and I include Obama's election run in that, they used these tools to alter U.S. electoral outcomes. So at least one thing an organization could do is to say, we're the source of value when you need long-term, persistent focus on one set of outcomes. To take another example, when the Catholic Church, when the Boston Globe went after the Catholic Church in the early part of last decade for the priestly abuse scandal, there was a huge worldwide uproar among the world's Catholics. Right, the story rocketed around the globe within days, and the continued trouble the Catholic Church has had in controlling that story, which is something they'd successfully done in decades prior, indicated how much of this kind of upwelling of public sentiment, how powerful that had become. But it took the Boston Globe as an organization to be committed to the long haul reporting to get the story broken in the first place and to do it in a way that was unassailable. And so you start to think about what are the roles of an organization if coordinating short-term group action and disseminating information isn't a key part of the repertoire anymore. And longevity of focus and clarity of essentially points of leverage are two things that organizations do well that these kind of uprising groups don't. In my own case, the thing I'm probably most interested in, the defeat of PIPA and SOPA in the Senate and the House last week were the result of a kind of spontaneous uprising in which individuals and organizations simply all kicked in because the threat was felt to be dire. But that is not a great way to take on organizations that chip away a little bit at a time. The MPAA's mistake, the Motion Picture Association of America's mistake, was to simply go after too much all in one big bite. So now a bunch of us are looking around saying, what are the organizations that can look after these issues when it goes into relatively minute negotiations in particular House committees rather than a single all or nothing vote? And that is the place, I think, where organizational partnership with these kind of communal upwellings becomes actually more important than it used to be.
Great. Great. Thank you, Clay. Another question that came in, I think, right at the very beginning of your presentation from Karen Radowski, who is a professional but also very involved in Limud International, asked a little bit about the revolutionaries in the Middle East and their use of social media. And she brought in some of the text about from Malcolm Gladwell that actually came up in a lot of our text work conversations.
Right.
And some
right.
of the disagreements that Malcolm makes regarding the statements he has about the limits of social media to really transcend
yeah.
language barriers and some cultural barriers. How do you react to that? And maybe give us a little of your thoughts.
As my friend Zainab Tufekci, who's a sociologist at the University of Maryland, says, the best response to Malcolm Gladwell in 2010 is all of 2011. What Malcolm got right in that article was that clicktivism doesn't work. The idea of sitting around at home on Facebook clicking, you know, shout outs for ending world hunger or what have you, that provides very little. It's not even such a good fundraising technique. That creates very little value. What he did not understand, and I think it's because he didn't talk to any of the people in the revolutionary situation in the Middle East, is that using Facebook and being willing to risk your life for freedom are not actually incompatible thoughts. So in the book, in Here Comes Everybody, in chapter, I think it's 7 or 8, the chapter called Faster and Faster, the chapter that's most specifically about politics, I interviewed Abd el Fattah, who later became one of the architects of the Tahrir Square uprising, and has since been arrested by SCAF, by the Egyptian Supreme Council of the Armed Forces. So, el Fattah was working against the Mubarak regime for a decade before the Tahrir Square uprisings, and if there was something inherent in social media that meant the people who were committed to using these tools to organize themselves, to spread the word, to document the results, were somehow not serious people, if the fact that this medium could be used to spread lolcats meant it couldn't be used for politics, Gladwell might have had a point. But what he didn't understand is that the medium could be used for cracking people up on their coffee breaks, and it can be also be used for hijacking National Police Day. And that, I think, is the example that has most dramatically demonstrated what's possible with these tools that wasn't possible even a few years ago. Tomorrow, the first year anniversary of the January 25th uprising. January 25th in Egypt was National Police Day. And the anti-Mubarak camps said, let's hijack that day. Let's broadcast a message that says January 25th is a day of protest, not because it's National Police Day. Now, to do that, they needed a way to spread that message as effectively as the state could spread the message about National Police Day. But, of course, they weren't allowed to do it in any newspapers. They weren't allowed to do it on the radio. They weren't allowed to do it in television. The only tools they had, mobile phones and the net. And yet they were able to disseminate a message that broke the state's narrative of what the day was about, and they were able to do it using tools they had in their pocket. So Gladwell, I think, to be perfectly frank, as someone who doesn't understand these tools very well, still has the sense of, oh, kids use them for silly things, therefore they're not political. Not understanding that with the end of the Cold War, the old assumption that politics happened when governments negotiated, that era has passed, and we are back in an era of mass political movement. And the biggest issue that people trying to foment mass political movement face is coordination. So tools that lower coordination costs end up getting used in all of these political dimensions. As I said, not just in Tunis and Cairo, but in Athens and Tel Aviv and Santiago and New York and so forth.
Thank you, Clay. Another question that you've inspired by a few different folks, Beth Cousins and a few others, is to really apply some of this language and thinking to churches, synagogues, religious institutions. How do they, as you just talked about, mass political movements in a faith-based arena, use some of this theory and convert it into action?
Well, so one of the things that those kinds of organizations do implicitly well is to understand that there are simply more and less committed members, and that they offer a range of sort of opportunities and services and so forth across all of those groups. So they don't, congregating religious organizations don't typically have the problem that, say, the media has. They don't have to give up the audience illusion in the first place. And then what you start to see is, are there places where these churches can actually open themselves up, essentially more as a platform for their members to decide issues to commit to, ways to take action, and so on, right? The best argument ever for hierarchical, essentially hierarchical decision making and coordination is simply that the cost of having a group come to some kind of shared understanding and then taking action is too high. But if you've got something that lowers that cost, then you start to get a situation where members of those groups can commit to one another to taking action. And it has to be done in a way that's compatible with the faith, and if the church or the synagogue or the mosque is going to get involved, it has also to be compatible with their public image. But there are places where, particularly around causes that have to do with social change, there are many places where those organizations have been led by their members instead of vice versa. Certainly the history in the Protestant religions around gay marriage in this country has very much been a place where the ability of the parishioners who care about that issue to coordinate with one another and to bring the message to the church has inverted the usual order. Then the question becomes, what can the religious institution do to say, because we're already a convening platform, we exist on some level to bring the congregation together, what are the ways that we can extend those tools to people's commitments outside of just attending once a week or just tithing or whatever?
So, Will Berkovitz of Repair the World wrote, "People gather hive-like when there is a crisis. How do you keep the community together when there is no crisis in a relevant way?"
Yeah, right.
Maybe you could respond to that, please.
Yeah, so you don't. And that's, I think, one of the really essential differences here. It's hard to understand because it's so different from the normal model. But, in fact, you can't – the largest group you can get committed to an issue during a crisis is going to be a very vast superset of the largest group you can keep together in an ongoing way. And so where I think we're going, and I'm seeing this with SOPA and PIPA, is essentially a system of mutual trust and alarm bells. So I'm seeing groups after SOPA and PIPA say to people who've never before turned out to a political demonstration in their lives, this will happen again. People try and censor the internet again. We understand that you, the members of the American public, are not going to become free speech radicals. You're not going to start joining civil liberties organizations or going regularly to meetings or even contributing money. But we also understand that you are willing to turn out if things get to be a crisis. So the trick becomes, you let us know how to contact you, and we promise only to contact you in time of crisis. Because when an organization commits itself to essentially trying to radicalize everybody, what they end up doing instead is alienating most of everybody. But when an organization says that, you know what, we read the news so you don't have to, right? Our issue is, you know, we protect journalists as with Committee to Protect Journalists, or we're the Electronic Frontier Foundation or what have you. The people inside that organization would love to get everybody in the United States worked up about those issues all the time, but they can't. And so the design question now becomes, if you're putting together an organization that may want to engage in some kind of mass mobilization, is to say, how do we keep a committed core of people who are watching this issue all the time, but are occasionally, like a volunteer fire department, able to sp- spread an issue far beyond the bounds of the community that stays intact when it isn't a crisis, so that we can rally people when it is a crisis. And this is a very different set of organizational skills from we want everybody to be and stay a member all the time. But in a way, the flip side of low costs of reaching people is a high degree of changed commitment. People will commit quite a lot when an issue comes to the fore, when a crisis comes to a head. But then their decommitment on the other side is going to be equally high, right? If we were to try and have another turnout, for example, around the Pipasopa issue, like we had last week, we wouldn't get a tenth. We might get a hundredth of the turnout. So the institutional design problem becomes how do we understand and respect that fact and work with it, keeping the committed core able to rally the larger group, but without requiring the larger group to think of themselves as committed ongoing members, but rather people who can be recruited in our time of need.
Clay, thank you. So another question that takes us in a bit different direction is from Leah Mayer of the Avihai Foundation, who asks, how can organizations effectively make use of cognitive surplus to achieve more abstract goals, like motivating people to learn more about their Jewish identity or getting them to consider how they relate to other Jews, as opposed to concrete goals like a particular vote or a very specific activity?
Right. Well, This is a generalization because the design problems are often fairly specific. But one of the things we've seen over and over again is that people respond better to concrete invitations than to abstract invitations. And that very often the challenge becomes designing the concrete invitations. Will you come and edit this article? To take the Wikipedia example, and to have the abstract goal result from that. So very few people who edit Wikipedia, of the millions who've edited it, you know, cumulatively, have gone there because they are motivated by making all of the world's knowledge available. They go there because they have a thing they want to put into the Pluto article, or they have a thing they want to put into the article about U.S. Route 66 or what have you. And yet, for the percentage of them that get hooked on that, who come to self-define as Wikipedians, they end up committing to making all the world's knowledge available, simply because over time, the daily practice of commitment to the smaller issues adds up to the larger practice of commitment to the larger issues. So if you say to people, we're going to help you explore this aspect of your identity, that will appeal to some group. But if you say to people, we want to talk about the history of Jerusalem, or we want to talk about the history of the diaspora, do you want to know something about your heritage? We're going to reach you personally, so maybe you came from Romania, or maybe you came from Russia, and we'll have a different story to tell you, depending on which of those things is true about you. But over time, that sense of, oh, I started pulling on a little thread and it just kept getting longer and longer, that turns out to be, for a pretty wide range of projects, a better way to commit to larger, longer sense of identity, membership, and so forth, than going straight for the, wouldn't you like to join this community and have your identity bound up in this abstraction? Because even when that answer is yes, people very often don't get their all-in-one leap.
Clay, one question that's come in building on these past two questions is from Sarah Schoenberg of BBYO, who's asked how this applies to a very tangible way in fundraising. So again, I think people, some of the audience that's listening to you, is understanding how this fits in some very concrete ways. But in raising money, is there a difference? That people should be looking through a different prism, or how do you address that?
Yes. So the single most important thing to understand about the effect on fundraising is that a fundraising transaction does two things. It gives the organization the money it needs to survive and pay its bills and keep the lights on and all of that, and it is an expression of the identity of the giver. And when you lower all of the social, all of the costs of social attestation and interaction, you get, again, this classic distribution. There will be a handful of people, the mockers, the tentpoles, the people who are setting themselves up to keep Organization X alive, and they will continue to give regularly and generously as they always have. But you will be able to get much, much further out on the long, flat tail of givers. And the people who worked this out first and best were the Dean campaign, a pattern then copied brilliantly by the Obama campaign. Where what Dean realized was, if you give me $5, I have $5 more than I had before you gave it to me, which is okay, but not doesn't mean much for a multi-million-dollar campaign. But it means an enormous amount to me if you think of yourselves as having committed in however small a way to my election. And it means even more if you are willing to tell other people that you did it. So I think the two big ramifications of this thought of fundraising are, go for the people who've never given before and get them to give you $5 or $10. And get people who give you money to assert to their friends or their audience or however they think of this, whether it's Facebook or Twitter or Google Plus or what have you, that they have done this. A tradition seems to have sprung up this year on Twitter for people listing the organizations that are in their end-of-year charitable contribution list. And that kind of attestation is enormously valuable because people, we are social animals, we take our cues from one another. And for someone to see, oh, that person who I respect just gave money to an organization that I heard of but have never given to, that is your marketing budget, right? That is your customer acquisition cost. And those two effects together, reaching people you've never reached before for very small amounts of money, but bringing them into the fold, and getting people to publicly affirm that they think that this donation is a good thing to do, those two effects are much, much easier to achieve in this medium than they were in previous fundraising efforts where you do a mail shot or whatever. And the mail shot, if it gets there and it goes straight to recycling, remains inert. But if I send you a message and you forward it on in any way, I've suddenly reached people that I didn't even know existed before. And so this treating of fundraising not like a broadcast problem but like a networking problem, I think essentially leads you to reconceive of both who you can reach at what dollar amount and how much incremental value they have by talking about your organization afterwards.
Thank you. So a different question, similar in the vein of from looking at things from an organizational perspective. Josh Avedon of Jumpstart out in Los Angeles asks, given that collective action can happen so diffusely, how can organizations get or claim credit for outcomes that are the result of an action they initiated? For example, sometimes just affecting change, as you mentioned, is reward enough, but sometimes an organization must be able to say they were responsible demonstrate attribution for funders or for other key stakeholders. How do you balance those two?
You know, I mean, that is a very real tension, in part because, as has always happened, these successes are always multivariate, right? Success is rare enough that when it happens, it's always got a whole bunch of improbable causes. Part of what's happened now is that it's easier to get many more participants involved, and part of what happens now is simply all of the kind of improbable ways that these things happen have just become more visible. So the question for an organization, I think, is twofold. One is, as I don't know who said this, but as someone famously remarked, it's amazing what you can get done if you don't need credit for it. So on some level, an organization just has to say to itself around any given set of issues, here are the things that we're pursuing because they're the right things to do, whether or not we get credit for them. And then here are the other things for which we have to get credit. But the other thing I think is you simply have to be able to present to funders or other organizations a portfolio that says, at this critical moment, we either kicked something off that later became big, or we intervened to make something possible that had previously been impossible. But, you know, as has often been observed with, you know, this is the oldest tension in the world between funders and organizations. No one wants to kick money into the general fund. They want to fund a specific initiative as if that initiative alone, if given the right money, could succeed or fail, even though it rests on the back of, you know, whatever, the Red Cross, Doctors Without Borders, what have you. So part of it, frankly, becomes a conversation about educating funders that what the organization is doing is one, the organization becomes smart enough to understand where the moments of intervention and the points of high leverage are, and two, that it acted as at those moments. But I think the idea that, you know, the idea already something of a fantasy that a single organization could cause a movement to happen, as the amount of user documentation and user-to-user conversation around radicalizing or participating in these various issues, as that just becomes broadly visible to everybody, it just becomes harder and harder to engage in that kind of conversation with the funder, because everybody knows on some level that the it's now much more like a game of soccer in which there are in which there are strong rewards for being a player who assists making goals, and the illusion that there is essentially a single person who made a goal starts to fade into the background. So this medium makes it harder to step forward to a funder and say, you gave us X money and we did Y thing, and as a result, the Z event happened. That's harder. That's now a harder conversation to have, both because there are many more participants that can get involved, and because the evidence that actually all success is multivariate is just much more available. Right? Any organization that went and took credit for PIPA and SOPA would essentially be shot down by all of the other organizations that kicked in together. So, I think really the big lesson here is educating funders that what they want are organizations that are adept at reading the situation, understanding where the leverage points are, and acting decisively and correctly, rather than organizations that can say, you bought and paid for an event that we created.
Great. Thank you, Clay. So we have a few students joining us from Hebrew Union College in California, and one of them wrote a question about the difference between leadership and management, and I'll read the question and let you react to it. The difference between an ad hoc group and a company like Microsoft is management. And quotes John Cotter's, good management brings a degree of order and consistency to key dimensions. Leadership, by contrast, is about coping with change. So, Clay, the question for you is, do you agree with that assessment? And what are your thoughts regarding management versus leadership?
Well, first of all, I think that is an excellent question. That assessment sounds pretty good to me, with I think one caveat, which is to say that when you are in an environment that is committed to change in an ongoing way, leadership becomes a slightly different job. Leadership essentially becomes knowing when to intervene and when not to. So I'll give you an example, not from any of the organizations we've been talking about, but from the programming world. Linus Torvalds, who is the creator of the Linux operating system, 20 years old just now, has on some occasions stepped in and used his role as absolute dictator to say, we are simply not doing X. At one point, people wanted to make the core part of the Linux operating system natively good at handling video. And what Linus knew, and this is maybe 10 years ago, what Linus knew was that Linux was going into all these little devices, watches and things, that didn't have video outputs. And so he said, basically, over my dead body, will that happen? So in that case, as a leader, he went in and exhibited just total control. No. At a later point, people were working on something called virtualization, which is to say, essentially what made Linux cloud friendly. It's what made the so-called cloud possible, the network of interconnected computers. And although Linus wasn't interested in virtualization, he understood that that's where the community wanted to go, and he didn't interfere. So leadership in open systems becomes less about coping with change, because open systems are simply more amenable to change, and it becomes more about knowing when to intervene and when not to. So, where as I said in Here Comes Everybody, it really comes down, from my point of view, to an organizational attitude towards failure. The effect of failure on an organization is the likelihood of failure times the cost of failure. And management is a way of trying to reduce the likelihood of failure. Right? We're gonna do a lot of advanced planning to keep these bad things from happening. The problem with that is that we've all sat in that meeting where we've spent so much energy discussing whether or not something would be a good idea that it would actually have been easier to just try it and see. Right? And so that's in a way the response of the more open organizations to failure, is to try to reduce the cost of failure. That's what open source software does, par excellence. It's what wikis do. It's what communal conversation among participants could do in all kinds of endeavors. It's to simply make it cheaper to fail quickly and to use that to explore a larger terrain than a traditional organization can. So I would say, really, the attitude towards management as bringing consistency to consistency of execution, consistency of process, that there are now some kinds of organizations where reduction of the management overhead itself becomes part of the goal. Right? Wikipedia, to take again a long-lived example, has acquired more and more sort of managerial imperatives around its edge cases, principally biographies of living people, which has been a hard category to police. But they've done an amazingly good job of making the average contributor to a Wikipedia article never see anything that feels like management. And that is, I think, one of the things that's new in the current environment, is that the overall management reducing strategy in favor of essentially a strategy that just lets the change happen and sorts it out after the fact, is leading to a class of organizations we couldn't have imagined when the managerial imperative was the main imperative.
Great. So, Clay, one of the questions comes from Michael Hill of DeRote, who mentions that some of these revolutions that have been going on over the past year have used certain source texts or used certain language to kind of catalyze their groups. And the question comes to you, I think what he was referring to is dictatorship to democracy that has been passed around. So I wonder if either in that vein or with other texts and sources in mind, other than, of course, Here Comes Everybody and Cognitive Surplus, are there other resources or materials you'd suggest to this group to check out, to think about, and to explore as they go deeper into the ideas you presented today?
You know, one of the most interesting ones is David Graeber's book, Death, the First 5,000 Years. And what Graeber is concerned to do there, and he that is a source text, for example, for the Occupy movement. What Graeber is concerned to do there is to show that the model of financial transactions that is favored by neoclassical economics, which is to say transactions that happen in a bloodless way between isolated, rationally calculating actors, has never been normal in any human society. And in particular, the thought that we got money out of a barter system that works just like money has never actually happened. No anthropologists have ever found a society that works the way neoclassical economists say all societies work. So what Graeber's concerned to show, for example, is that in almost every transaction that is not so completely removed from day-to-day life as to essentially be a stock transaction, there is a social component. And by re-socializing the idea of transactions, by saying that every bit of transactional value carries some residue of social interaction, we can start to reimagine society as interacting units where people have a regard for one another and for one another's roles, and not just treating one another as kind of utilitarian sources of some amount of value for some amount of cash. Another is Yochai Benkler's The Wealth of Networks, which was his enormous compendium of examples of crowdsourced production. And Benckler was really ahead of all of us in putting academic rigor behind the idea that there were non-market-based modes of group production that were going to make certain kinds of group action possible that simply weren't possible under either managerial or market regimes. And then a third book, which is not yet a core text, but which I think should be, is Michael Nielsen's Reinventing Discovery. And what Nielsen sets out to do in that book is to say, science has always used media to maximize the value of group conversation, right? The printing press became one of the key inputs to the idea of peer review, right? Which is the thing that got, you know, the Francis Bacon notion of scientific inquiry into an actual practical state. So Nielsen looks at all the ways that networks are helping physicists compare data sets, that are helping biologists understand how proteins fold, and he just goes through a list of the capabilities that the network intelligence that we have access to is altering the way science works. What's so interesting to me about that book is it is, in a way, a crypto business book, although people have not realized it yet, because it's really about organizing group responses in the face of uncertainty, which is what scientists are operating in the face of all the time. In fact, if you're a scientist and you're only operating with certainty, you're not actually doing your job. And the kinds of solutions that Nielsen describes and the imaginative ways in which these scientists have deployed them, I think provides a way for all kinds of organizations to ask themselves, if I had access to the collective intelligence of the people I can reach, in a more engaged, more salient, more surprising way, what are the questions I would ask? What would I do with that? And that's what I think Nielsen's book does better than anything else I've read.
Great. So I'm going to ask you one last question, Clay, and then we'll have a few wrap-up comments and notes for the group. But you have become such a great, I think, translator of this idea for a lot of us and beyond this webinar. We ask you to be, rather than just a translator, a prognosticator for a moment. And if we couldn't have predicted what was going to happen over the past 12 months and the validation to some of the theory you've articulated or rebuttal to Malcolm Gladwell or in any event, new ways of looking at this this theory, how do you anticipate or what could you project or maybe a few ideas we should keep our eyes open for, or thoughts that might come and surprise us in the coming 12, 24, or 36 months?
Well, so I'm always hesitant. I will say to me, I'm always hesitant to prognosticate. If I look like a prognosticator, it's often just because I'm paying attention to different part of town than people live in, which is to say that things I'm seeing happen in one domain are actually happening right now, and they may just show up later, you know, may just show up other places later. So I will make a prognostication that's actually based on a real world event that I think may be a template for a big new change. I'll actually make two quick. One is the election of Woon Sun in Seoul, South Korea. And Sun was running for mayor of Seoul as an independent. He was not favored by either of the two main political parties, but used these social tools and the strength of his supporters and their willingness to attest to one another that he was the guy they wanted, that the Democratic Party was essentially forced to adopt him because he was more popular than their own candidate. And so that is the first example I know. And one thing to understand about South Korea is, unlike the United States, where being mayor of our biggest city, that's it for your political career. No New York mayors. It goes on to higher office. In South Korea, the mayor of Seoul is a good candidate for president of South Korea. So here's a place where the kind of glancing blow to party politics that we saw with Ross Perot in 1992 has actually come home in a democratic polity. An independent candidate didn't simply win, but actually forced the existing parties to bend to adopt him as their candidate. So I think one of the surprises that we may start to see is this business of individuals when they're being elected to executive roles like president, like mayor, like governor, may simply need party apparatus less. And I think that if that is the case, that is going to transform both presidential and parliamentary systems across the democratic world. Those changes will be slower than the Arab Spring because democracies always change more slowly than autocracies. But if that change happens, it will be a big deal. Another change, another prognostication I'll make is that we're going to see more use of structured arguing. That in the same way that the printing press led to new kinds of arguments, as with the scientific journals parallel, and we've seen it now with Wikipedia and with open source, this idea that people find new ways to fight with each other about what's important. I put you to an experiment called Open Knesset, where people are using GitHub, which is a tool for programmers to share source code. So what they're doing is they're copying proposed legislation from the Knesset. And they're saying, if you don't like this legislation, no more whining. Download a copy, change what you don't like, upload it again, and we can see where the disagreements are. So I don't know whether this will work or not. It may be that they don't get enough audience. But what I can see in that is the idea that if laws are structured arguments, that in a system with the right kind of structure, we can actually involve a much larger percentage of the citizens in arguing about what the laws should be. Right? You also see this in Iceland with the drafting of a constitution, a new constitution in the aftermath of the financial collapse, being done with the largest percentage of citizens ever consulted in constitutional drafting, again using these tools. So I think that both the possibility of altering party politics around executive functions and the possibility of greater citizen involvement in structured argument, if you're watching either the political domain or the business domain in terms of regulation, and certainly if you're watching the domain of membership organizations where users, young people in particular, are demanding more of a role, both of those changes I think are going to be a big deal.
Great. Clay, so thank you. So looking at our thank time you. And being respectful of your time in the audience, I want to thank you again for not only sharing your time with us, but I think a lot of thoughts that people are going to take back and work with in their professional careers and volunteer roles. I want to give the group a few last reminders. One, this session has been recorded. I think several of you have been chatting. Will it be recorded and available? We'll be sending out a message of where it will be accessible and how you'll be able to access the recording of Clay's talk. We'll also be sending out an evaluation of the TextWorks experience, both the prior book talks as well as this webinar, and we hope that you'll take a few moments to fill that out. It will help us understand both the impact of this particular program and looking ahead to other types of initiatives that might be of interest to you. And then we're going to also ask you to continue the conversation. This is not an end of the network thinking that Clay's introduced to us, but really a start, and would welcome you to visit our network blog at schusterman.org/networks, the Facebook group page, CLSPN Network, that many of you are a part of, and also on Twitter at the hashtag JNETS. And also remind you that you can follow Clay on Twitter at CS Shirky. And also, you can go to his webpage, shirky.com, for even more insights and observations that he shared with us today. So with that, Clay, I want to thank you again for your time, all of you in the audience for listening and participating, and have a great day.
Thank you, Seth. Thank you for having me, and thanks, everybody, for turning out.